Consider this picture, where a person wraps a rope around a refrigerator and begins to pull it. If we drew the force by the rope on the refrigerator, it would look like this. As a matter of nomenclature, a force exerted by a rope, wire, string, cable, etc., which all have the characteristic of being flexible objects, is referred to as a tension force or tension. And the symbol used for a tension force vector is a capital T, like this. Here are some comments about the way we will apply tension. Number one, the direction of the tension force is parallel to the rope or wire, etc. That's why in the picture, the tension force is shown parallel to or along the length of the rope. Number two, the tension force can only pull on an object. It cannot push an object. This is generally intuitive to us because the rope or wire, etc. is flexible and bends if you try to use it to push an object. And number three, the magnitude of the tension on each end of a segment of rope or wire, etc. is the same. So in this picture, if the right end of the rope pulls the refrigerator with a tension force of magnitude T, then the left end of the rope pulls on the person with tension force of the same magnitude T. Notice that the statement refers to a segment of the rope or wire, etc. I'll show you what this means by considering a new scenario. In this scenario, a block is suspended by some wires. Because of this connection point here, where the wires are all tied together, we will consider this to be three wire segments, and each wire segment potentially has a different tension. So one wire segment will have a tension force on each end of, say, T1, and another wire segment will have a tension on each end of, say, T2, and the third wire segment will have a tension on each end of, say, T3. The fourth comment I want to make about tension is that we will usually assume that the mass of the rope or wire, etc., is negligible as compared to the mass of the other objects involved. This assumption can greatly simplify our analysis. An interesting application is when the rope or wire, etc., goes through a pulley, like this. When a rope, wire, etc. goes through a pulley, we can typically neglect the mass and friction of the pulley, which means that the pulley changes the direction of the rope or wire, etc., but it doesn't change the magnitude of its tension. So in this picture, the tension force holding up the bucket has the same magnitude as the tension at the other end pulling the dog. Basically, we're considering this whole rope to be a single segment with one value of tension. The other interesting thing to note in this example is that the rope also pulls on the pulley with the same value of tension as the ends. So the tension force on the pulley looks like this. Okay, so here's an example to demonstrate all of the principles we just mentioned. Two blocks are suspended by three wires, A, B, and C, as shown. Wire C goes through a frictionless pulley. Find the tension to the three wires. The basic strategy here is to apply Newton's second law to each of the blocks. Let's start with the 2 kilogram block. Here's the force diagram for the 2 kilogram block and the coordinate scheme. There is only one contact point on the block, and that is wire C. So we have the tension force for wire C in the positive y direction, and then we have the force of gravity on the block in the negative y direction. Now we'll apply Newton's second law in the y direction, and putting in the forces, the equation becomes this. I'll go ahead and simplify the equation now by recognizing that the acceleration is zero, and now we can make the force of gravity mg and solve the equation for tension C. And putting in values for m and g, we get that tension C is 19.6 newtons, and we have our first answer. Now let's apply Newton's second law to the 4 kilogram mass. I'll first clear the previous equations to make room, and I'll add the value of tension C to the diagram because we'll need it later. Now I'll draw the force diagram for the 4 kilogram mass. There are three wires in contact with the mass, so we have those three contact forces, tensions A, B, and C, and then we have the gravitational force as well. Three of the four forces here are in the x and y directions, so we don't need trig to find their components. But tension C is at an angle, so we need to calculate its x and y components. Space is a little tight, so I'll redraw the tension C vector here. We know from our previous work that tension C is 19.6 newtons, so we can do the trig calculations to solve for the x and y components in tension C. which come out to be 17 newtons and 9.8 newtons respectively. Now we can apply the Newton's second law equation to the x and y directions. Let's start with the x direction. There are two forces in the x direction, tension A in the negative x direction and the x component of tension C in the positive x direction. And I'll go ahead and recognize that the acceleration is zero. So tension A equals the x component of tension C. And since we've already calculated the x component of tension C, then we know that tension A is also 17 newtons. Now let's apply Newton's second law in the y direction. In the y direction, there are three forces, tension B in the positive y direction, and the gravitational force and the y component of tension C, both in the negative y direction. Again, we can recognize that the acceleration is zero, and then solve the equation for tension B. We know that the gravitational force is mg, so we can make that substitution, and now we're ready to plug in values, which comes out to be 49 newtons for tension B. And that's it for this problem and this video. Notice that this video is called Tension Static Applications. Static means that the objects are not moving, which is why we were able to set the acceleration to zero. In the next video, we'll look at applications where the objects are accelerating. So see you then.